Dear God, thank you so much for this specific, wonderful evening that we could celebrate together and we get together to honor you with the gift of music, with the gift of film music. And thank you so much for Hannah, for her meticulous and hard work over the 4 years here on campus, seeing her grow tremendously in the film music. And I can't wait to see what you're going to do and how you're going to work through her to make her to become a Christ champion, so to say, in this area of film music. I know it's there are some greater things ahead of her, and I can't wait to see what's going to happen. I just going to pray that we're going to have awesome time thinking about you, thinking about Christ, thinking about Jesus. That's all we have is because of you. Now, Papa, we love you and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I present to you Hannah Levine.
Very overwhelmed because I'm really encouraged by how many of you are here to support me, so I just really want to say thank you for that. And before I start presenting my projects, I did want to say a few things just hopefully to encourage some of you, hopefully all of you, but I know that some of you in particular, especially music students, I just feel I've been learning some things that might lift you up a little bit. And I just want to be transparent because this semester was a really difficult one for me. With it being my final semester of film score instruction, I felt this overwhelming pressure that I needed to prove myself as a composer and a musician, and I let that become part of my identity, where I just developed this overwhelming anxiety. I know this is not very happy, don't worry. But I bet some of you can relate. And I started succumbing to this anxiety that I had to do enough, to be enough, that my skills and who I was not enough. And so that anxiety at first motivated me to do more work. But that same anxiety also totally distracted me. It zapped my creativity. It distracted me. I wasn't able to do nearly as much work as I have in even previous semesters. That's how it felt. And like I would rewrite and rewrite sections of my compositions over and over, just with this feeling that it wasn't enough. And just for some of you who are musicians who feel this pressure to prove yourself, to prove your worth and your abilities, that if you're my brothers and sisters in Christ, your worth and identity was set the moment that you decided to follow Jesus. Mm-hmm. Your worth is in the blood that Jesus shed for you, to have forgiveness, so that you could become a child of God. This is who you are, and you cannot take away from this victory with your failures, and you cannot add to it with your accomplishments. There's nothing you can do to change that. But where does that leave us? You know, as people who have work, we have vocations, how do we approach that now? And I just want to read this passage from Psalm 84. I'm sorry, I'm nervous. I'm not good at that. But it's important. These are important things. Psalm 84 says, "How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and a swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young at your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house, ever singing your praise." And that's where this leads us, is that we live from a place of worship then. And I love this picture of the bird that she's making the altar for resting place. This is where she lives. And because of that, everything that she brings forth is already a sacrifice to God. Not because she brings it as a separate thing, but because she herself is living there in that place of rest on the altar. And what about this thought that seems very prevalent in Christianity, that it's our job to exhaust ourselves in order to fulfill the work that God has called us to do? Well, Psalm 127 says, unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is vain that you rise up early and go late to rest, eating the bread of anxious toil. For he gives to his beloved sleep. Oh my God. So our first job as his children is to rest in him. Once we're in that place of resting, then we can accept the gifts of work and vocation that he gives to us with gratefulness rather than discontentment that we're not enough. And we can also make sure that he's the one building the house for us, that we're not stepping ahead of him. We're walking behind him, letting him guide us in that path. And after pushing so hard in this degree and standing here giving my senior presentation to you, I can tell you that I am no more able to follow God's will for my life or to be obedient today than I was the day that I started school. God has completely equipped you to be obedient to him today. And that's all we need to worry about. We don't need to think about our future calling as the point in which we're going to be able to follow God, and that we need to work so hard to prepare for that, because God is calling us to rest in him today, and he gives us everything we need to follow him right now. Let's see where I was though. And one more note, as creative people especially, I think we feel this pressure to make a name for ourselves, that in order to be successful, we need to have people know about us. But as Christians, that's not our calling in life. Our only calling is to make Jesus' name great, to lift that up. And it doesn't stop there, because when we've lived out our lives lifting Jesus' name high and have overcome, what does Revelation 2 say? This is in the letter to the church in Pergamum. It says, to the one who conquers, I will give him a white stone with a new name written on the stone. So in the end, God actually makes a name for us. And when we come to that place, all of our strivings to make something of ourselves in this life, to have people know about us, will be completely overshadowed by what he has made for us. So I just want to encourage you, because I know in this school, so focus on performance. It's really hard to remember these things. But me standing here is also a testament to God working and preparing and giving us gifts of work. So I'm really grateful for the progress that I've made. And I just want to thank Professor Piotrowski and Dr. Schmall especially. They're here every morning earlier than almost anybody else in this building. And they're working to try to transfer the genius that's up in here into their lesson plans and curriculum. So if we could just give them a round of applause. Concept car. This is an autonomous vehicle. This is very cool.
When I got this project, had to start from the ground up. There was supposed to be a voiceover, but there, I had it with zero sound is what I had to work from. So the first step in doing a track before composing, if it needs a voiceover, do the voiceover first. And I was extremely blessed because Carlton Yelton is here. Could you stand up if you can see it? He was willing to do the voiceover for me, and it was amazing. He did it in like two passes, and like you'll see, he's really good. So thank you, Carlton. After we've got the narration down, then you score around the narration because you need to play around the phrases. I took a more textural approach, and so you've got a lot of evolving textures that play around fading in and out, filter sweeps to go along with the changes in the images, and also to go around the voiceover. So, all right.
What moves us forward? Not time, not fame, or the promise of glory. People. I've lit the way for visionaries, been muse to 1,000 artists. The powerful found peace. The people I've moved have changed the world and walked the road no one else dare tread. For more than a century, I've watched and witnessed people emerge into the light of a new day. We began to move together, turning what ifs into what's next. We imagined the future and made history. Those who pursue perfection forge their own path, and this journey has just begun. Welcome. For the next 100. Are you ready?
With filters, with other effects to make that change happen with automation. So just something interesting that I learned this one. Yes, Brandon?
How did you decide, there's so many different cues that you could have used throughout that piece, and like doing all of them would have been like so busy, but you like basically chose like which ones to use and which ones not to. Like how do you make that decision of which cues to use for like sound effects and not to?
Oh, okay, like what sounds to use here and there?
How you decide which ones to use on, which ones to use and which ones not to.
It's a good question. I think a lot of it is intuitive as far as playing with textures, combining them. with light, though. So when you're looking at a scene and you've got motion, you've got light, if there's light, chances are you're going to bring in some high-end sounds. Mm-hmm. And so finding sounds that have more of that twinkle to them to shift in as the light's changing to brighter, that's part of it. I don't know if that answers your question. Yeah. Any other questions?
Was that all done in the Media Lab too, with what we had in Logic, or did you have some?
Yeah, I did this myself. It's a whole lot of alchemy. I did this as in on my own setup. A whole lot of alchemy. I used some of the lab's patches, like the frozen strings and some of the cello, amplified cello stuff, because those are great. They're just evolving sounds, and with those I kind of fade them in and out to just add to the texture. Yeah, it was a whole lot of alchemy.
Did you write the voiceover for that, or was that just a re-recording of it,
the
original script?
Yeah, that was a script that Professor C provided to me. Right? Where did you get
that? That's original.
It was the original script.
That's the original production script. Yeah.
Yes, Jen.
So are there commercials like this, and you watch it? Or is there something where you already need to create it for me?
Yes, so this is just a project, like an exercise for me to be able to practice. So basically, Professor C gives me the video file, we strip it of audio, and then I can start from scratch again so that I can recreate, not necessarily what they had, but create something that I would do as a composer.
Do you not listen to it, so influence you?
I've started to listen to things more because I'm like, I need help. I used to feel like that was cheating, and then I'm like, well, I need to learn more, so I probably listen to all of these. That's a good question. Any other questions? No? All right, can we move on? All right, so another car commercial. They're fun. This is for BMW X7, which is a luxury vehicle. And this one, I think I did this one last semester. I struggled with this at first because I took kind of a lighthearted approach at first, a little bit like the last one, kind of ethereal textures. And you'll see in this advertisement that there are harder cuts, some darker colors, and there's also no voiceover, so there's not as much of a human element. So my first version didn't work so well, it was kind of light. Second version took some darker harmonies, deeper tones, a little distortion, added a trap beat, and it worked a whole lot better, just so you can see, like, you have to do different versions of things to get something right the first time. But this one has a lot of moments, like I was saying to Brandon, where light enters the image, and you hear some higher frequency tones come in to highlight those changes. So you'll see that, yes.
So if you were to produce something like this for like a national television channel, whatever you would call that, what sort of levels do you have to set for that? Like, is what we're hearing what you would hear or what you would send to somebody? Does that make sense?
If it was national advertisement, I would get somebody to professionally mix and master it just to get those who's used to working with that kind of commercial work and knows what kind of levels. For advertisement, you really want to push it to the max, but you don't want to lose your dynamic power, I suppose. I don't know if this sounds right, Professor C, but you've got ads come on your TV, and they're always louder than the TV show. So so I would get it to somebody who, I don't know if that answers your question.
Almost, yeah, pretty close. Like, how much of the musical composition of yours is really fiddling with levels as opposed to just composing stuff.
Oh, so much. Yes. Yeah, producing side of things is huge. I'll spend maybe half the time putting together the tracks that I want, and then I'll spend the rest of the time working out automation curves, working with effects to have that kind of motion. You could have one track and automate an effect, and that could accompany the picture better than it would sometimes to just add another instrument in when the picture changes. So that side of production is really a big deal here. That's a good question. Luke.
How did you come up with like the high algorithm? Like it was really nice and groovy. Did you like shoot the drummer loops or did you?
Yeah, it was the trap beat that I got from Loops.
Really fast, really long, kind of like a drum fill kind of thing in the hi-hat.
Yeah, so the trap is this really wide beat, and then you've got these quick hi-hat fills. You're right, yeah, that's like characteristic of what a trap beat is.
It was really nice.
Some of your synth patches had some rhythmic elements. Did you use any side chaining to achieve those, or were they built in rhythms?
Yeah. So I used side chaining just with regular kick drum to get that movement. I've used that on several tracks, actually. And then some of them also just using step effects to give it that movement beyond kind of jittery movement. Yeah. Brandon?
Do you use any other plugins besides what's on Logic?
No, not really. I'm a newbie. Someday. Yes, definitely.
Well, when you're deciding how you want to orchestrate this out and you're using Logic's patches, do you spend a lot of time deciding and experimenting with the samples that are already in front of you, or do you kind of have a plan of how you actually want it to sound? Like, I mean, it, as a beginning composer, you may not necessarily know what those samples sound like until you actually go to them and listen to them. But did you actually have like a kind of an idea in your head of what you wanted to sound? Did you have to sound a lot first?
That's a great question. Something with this genre, okay, this is probably for most of the composers who are here, but when you're composing orchestral and you've got your project lined up, it's easy enough to divide those instruments by category of instrument family. But when I'm working with a track like this, which is heavily electronic, organizing them that way doesn't work because it's electronic instruments. And so the way that I set it up before I start doing a whole lot of composing is I'll organize them by, like, okay, these are rhythmic, motion, bright, warm, pads. And then because I have a general idea of what would fit the visual, but then for specific sounds, I'll just go perusing for a while, and I'll just be like, I like that one, I'll stick that in this folder. And then I can just draw from my palette within those folders of which sounds I end up liking, because there's a lot of that experimenting with sounds before you decide what it actually should be.
But you have some sort of category.
What?
But you have some sort of category.
Yeah, I think that I've developed a little bit more of an ear for that, but a lot of it is still trial and error. Anybody else? Dr. Hunt?
Yeah. Were you looking for a specific audience that's going to buy this card, age group, or gender as you were writing? It seems like the dance...
It's kind of a male image here.
It seemed to be very female to me when I was seeing this girl. and the dance part of it, rather than kind of the big whooshy kind of adventure pieces that would be appealing to a male audience.
I think that maybe I have some more growth to do in that area of gender psychology.
I think the dance was very effective. I think as you're working with a producer, they would probably dial into that.
Definitely.
And I think they were appealing to rich white females. I mean, just the pictures and everything just showed that to me in a very big way. And I think the dance really was that. I really felt like that's what you were talking about.
Cool. That's good. Yes, I need to think more in terms of that too, as far as the gender and demographic. Okay, anybody else have any other questions? Nope. Okay, we can move on. This one is Nike Air, which is a shoe that the advertisement is pretty much meant to make you think that it's lightweight, it's comfortable, it's springy, you've got all these fast cuts. And it's a very heavy sound design advertisement, so we need to create a music track but with sound effects that are related to the shoe. So the first step in doing this was to collect samples. I collected some actually in the gym, like a crazy person, and I walked around the gym with my just like walking. There's a person on this treadmill, like, that's a nice rhythm, and I'll just like some of them I collected myself, but a lot of them I had new ideas of sounds I wanted, and I was able to find them online, and I downloaded them. When you do that, especially collecting your own samples, you need to process them with compression and EQ before you do this, which is one of my downfalls. I had to do a lot more processing after the fact because I wasn't super familiar with how to process them ahead of time. So first thing, if you don't know the drummer track in Logic, is also a sampler, so you can drop your own samples into that, into the different grid, and pretty much load any beat that you want within Logic, and have it play with your samples that you've put in there. So that's where I started, was with finding a tempo that worked well, finding a groove in the drummer that I liked, and then from there I took additional sound effects to highlight the motion that would work on top of that. And logos too, there are two logos. The first one, you've got the Nike logo, and just that motion, I brought in a panning and scooping sound with some crowd cheering. And then the second logo is a hard cut, and I paired it with, as Professor C calls it, the being hit in the head with a baseball bat. Enjoy. Feedback of what your work has been at that point. So that's really cool. Yeah. solid 8 hours of content. And I got to like listen to the whole night happening again. And there were a lot of backpacks. And so, yeah, I used a lot of those backpacks.
Can we see it again?
Sure.
I wanna hear the backpack sound.
Animation is challenging but really fun because you get to catch a lot of visual moments, which is cheesy, and that's what you're supposed to do. So it was a really fun one for you. This is about Wallace and Gromit, and there's a serial killer named Paella who is trying to kill Wallace with a bomb inside a cake, and as usual, Gromit is coming in to save the day. Two facets of scoring animation especially is to first start with the vertical aspect where you're finding your tempos first, you're finding meters, and then after you've decided where your biggest hits are going to be, then you can fill in the gaps with your thematic material. So then composing a theme that I can kind of use more typically in the smaller moments, but also pull across a longer phrase that will work in the longer moment. Yeah, that's good. Then they'll give it to others to flesh out with more ornamentation or the orchestrate. So just dividing out the different roles in that way. Typically, there won't be more than one composer in that main composer role on a film. think there'd typically be a hierarchy. Professor Steve, does that sound right, though? Can you check me?
Yeah, sound effects, sound designer, then there's Foley, mm-hmm. then there's composer, then there's different layers of course.
Yeah. So I guess another aspect of that is that as composers, there's also going to be a whole lot to do really fast. And so that's why we work really hard to learn tips with the technology that we have to be able to work as fast as we can. As fast as we can get those creative ideas in our head, we can put it down into the computer and that way get something that is bigger in scope done. Does that answer your question?
Maybe you could share how you use your sound effects implementation here, so to maybe answer the question.
The sound effects?
Yeah, so if you use your own sound effects.
Okay.
Like candle, recording candle sound, sparkle.
Oh, sure. Okay. Yeah, I did put some sound effects in there with the candle spark, the match. Quack, the shovel hitting, grommet as he flew down. Also, the poor dog getting slapped. Give him a little squeal, which felt cool. Yeah, so typically though on a larger film, this would be one person's job is to do the, or a team, depending on the project, to do the sound effects. It would not be the job of the composer to do that. Yes, anybody else?
Did you not like the slow-mo?
The king!
It's like you covered that up. Did you not like that?
So what I did that first the hearing was I shifted the sound of the horns and the gong so that we first hear him go, "Kay!" And then it follows with that. So that was my adjustment. I don't know if it was enough, but that's what we did after the hearing. Anybody else? Yes.
Did you, through the process, like as one piece from beginning to end, or did you kind of work from the hits and work backwards and forwards, like in segments?
I definitely had to go segments with something like this, just because you lead up to a certain point and you've got to decide, okay, in this section, what's the climax of that moment? Is there going to be a pause? And so then you compose up to that point and you kind of have to break it out into sections like that.
Yeah. But you started kind of from the beginning of the film or just all over kind of where you have the situation?
Yes. I think it depends, but yes, sometimes I just jump around. It depends on what's in my mind. Brandon.
How do you determine the BPM that best matches with the cues and the cuts and all that?
Great question. There is a feature in Logic that takes cuts from the scenes for you, from a film that you import, and creates markers out of them. But I actually, I don't tend to use that a whole lot. Instead of that, I create my own scene cuts because I feel like I can line them up a little better than the machine does for me. Then you lock the sempty or time code position on those by turning them into scene cuts, because that's a feature of scene cuts. And then you can use tempo mapping, aligning with those markers so that you're taking your tempo track and you're just dragging to get your tempo lined up. So that's part of the lining it up specifically, but even before you do that, you have to just listen and find a tempo that works approximately for most of that section. Yes. Anybody else? All right, move on. This one is very challenging to me. Okay, so this one is about 5 minutes long, which with the thickness of textures, this was the longest composition of this scope that I had done. Where with like the previous click, I was able to compose almost motivically, like in small little melodic segments. With this one, not even just finding a theme that worked would do. I needed to find multiple themes, break them down into their sections, and then develop those themes in different ways. Also overlapping them a lot of the times because of the scene is a bit twisters. So you need to have this frenetic swirling feel. And so we need to have like overlapping phrases, lots of layers in your textures that still somehow work together. So that was a very challenging thing for me orchestrationally. Because this was so challenging and really in orchestration especially, I ended up doing a lot of analysis with this one, just to see what other composers were doing. Especially, I did study Bernard Herrmann's scores, Stark Hart is the original composer of The Wizard of Oz, and Professor C got the score for the whole Wizard of Oz film, which is really awesome. And it's got a piano reduction at the bottom, and I used that a lot because I was able to play this, the piano reduction of the score, and kind of feel what that score was like in the textures. And that was really helpful to give me ideas, because rather than just reading it or listening, I could feel it. I analyzed Kavinsky, what else? So much analysis, I can't remember. Anyway, I'm done talking. You can listen to it.
Anna, do you want to present your instrument that you used in the film?
Or should I do that right now?
Yeah.
Okay. Professor C recommended this. So I just want to give him some credit for this sound of beauty that you're going to hear in the score, but that I will also play for you right now because it's so much fun. And yep, this is how it works if you haven't already seen me play it, which a lot of you have because I've been too excited about it. All right, let's see if I can do this.
Oh,
uses a lot for that effect of making it just like feel like you're being jerked in another direction, and also with offsetting the downbeat with different accents and with meter changes or division changes, like going from straight eighths to going to triplets and back. But it also has to do with trying to line up with the next scene section or any hits, so that was also in consideration.
Did you ever think about artists that are like EQing the tone and timbre of the music to match the EQ, the tone and timbre of the audio of the time?
I didn't consider that in units, but you know, Professor C was telling me about a plugin that can do that for you, that can kind of create that more plastic tone. So that's something to think about in working with older clips. That's a good thought. Anybody else?
What virtual libraries were you using? It sounded really authentic. I like the. Yeah.
I was using East West Libraries.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
I had to do some doctoring in it.
And the song.
Made it out of heaven.
Yeah.
And the song.
And the song.
Was the saw the only live instrument? Or did you have any other players?
I also recorded about 24 or 36 tracks of myself singing vocals for the choir. Yes, I think that was it though. Saw and then the choir. Yeah.
How did you get the movement at the end? It sounded really authentic. Like,
how did I get the what?
Piccolo. Like, how did you? What exact passage did you use for the flute for the piccolo at the end? And how did you capture that? Because it sounded like the most authentic.
I can't remember what patch I used. I want to say I tried to use legato for those solo sections, but I find sometimes the legato doesn't have the vibrato I want in it, so it could have been just a set. I'm not sure though.
It sounded really good. Nice.
Cool, thank you.
Give it up for Hannah.